sweating.
I'm so thrilled. So today, so if you think about the roadmap of what we have done, where we are, we have in this class, well, let's actually go back all the way through the whole series, right? You started off with 210, univariate response data. You began with just an estimating equation. Nobody told you that that's what it was, but you were first introduced that. You said, let's just minimize this into square errors. And then you went from that to say, well, yeah, but we want to do inference. And so now I'll assume normality of the residuals, normality of the response, and almost elasticity. And there, you were able to use multivariate normal theory and derive just the distribution of those ordinaries for the estimators. They became linear combinations of multivariate normals. They were multivariate normal back. You could write down their variance. You could do inference. And life was good. And then you met me. And then I said, well, okay, suppose, though, that you don't have the homostasticity or the normality. Well, the normality side of that, we could rely upon what? If I don't have normality, I'm still using those same estimators, ordinary squares. Lennard-Rockefeller central limit theorem, right, Jalen? That's our friend. And said, okay, these things will still be normal. So, and if I've got homostasticity, the variance of those ordinary squares estimators will still be sigma squared times x transpose x. Right, so we were could still do inference, life was still good. Okay. And efficiency, yes, we got that from Gauss-Markov. It said if we had constant variance, then equally weighting each of those contributions to the sum of squared errors was the right thing to do. Okay. Then when we drop the constant variance, though, we realize normality still holds, but we've got to deal with getting the variance correct. We've got to be able to estimate the variance correctly. So we had a couple of ways to do that. One was weighting these squares. That's great if you know what the weights are. Two was a transformation. Not so great in the sense that once you start transforming the data and you start taking expectations of nonlinear transformations, you lose the interpretation. Right? Saw that? And then three was just an empirical fix to the variance, basically the robust variance estimator, right? Just take what you've got and use a plug-in estimator to understand the size of the method of multiple estimators. Okay, great. Then we went to GLMs. We started the whole process over again. We said, okay, well, let's just start by assuming an exponential family, write down the log likelihood, think about what maximum likelihood theory gives us there. It gives us all this very beautiful theory, right? It says our estimates, our beta halves, will be asymptotically normal. They will have mean centered at beta. In other words, they'll be consistent. And then they'll have variance equal to Fisher information inverse, which you could write down based upon just the second derivative of the log likelihood. Great. So that was all. But then again, throw a wrench into the plans and you say, but suppose you estimated it wrong. And that's where we started off with this class, right? And I already assumed the distribution incorrectly. And so what we realized was if we assume the distribution incorrectly, we still get the asymptotic normalities back to Lennard-Rockefeller. Same thing again. What we were looking at, by the way, the linear regression case is just a special case of the GLM. Okay. And so we're back to three ways to fix the variance again, right? So really two ways, truly, because the transforming of the response really doesn't come into play anymore because you've got a known univariance relationship, so there's no transforming it away. Unless you get a variance stabilizing transformation, that would be different. So one was to say, okay, well, I can assume a different variance. In other words, back to weight least squares again, just assume a different mean variance relationship and hope that I get it right. The other way was to, again, throw an empirical variance estimate. That was all the Huber-White stuff that we did. Then we stepped back and said, well, now let's take it to the multivariate response case, right, for a continuous response. Well, back to the old sums of squared errors. But now you know that you have to do some weighting because there's correlation inside of the cluster, right? And that's everything we've been dealing with is by design, there's likely to be correlation within the cluster. So the idea is to choose a weight matrix that's approximately equal to the variance covariance matrix for the responses. That gains you back efficiency. You still have Lennard-Rockefeller on your side for normality, and you didn't have to clean up the variances if you were wrong in your assumption, right? Things won't collapse. Okay. The alternative to that, and those were marginal models, right? So in other words, what when I wrote those models down, I just had fixed effects inside of those models. I didn't have any random effects when we first started, right? With the general linear model correlating data. So then we said, well, another way to build in the variance covariance structure is through allowing for a random effect on the cluster. Right? So we thought about random intercepts, we thought about random slopes, and then we thought about serial processes on top of that. And again, those things become useful in two settings, I would argue, and you've looked at this in homework. One is if prediction is your goal, allowing for random effects on the trajectories can be useful. And you saw examples of that where you saw kind of ridiculous marginal effects for a person when you've got information that says they should be down here or they should be up here, right, relative to the population. Hopefully we all saw that on homework. Yeah? Would anybody opt to use those marginal models for prediction rather than the random effect models where you get the empirical data estimates? Okay, so we're all agreed there. So that becomes the utility of these things, right? If prediction is your goal, a random effects model can be quite useful. You can tailor these your predictions to the cluster using the information from the cluster. Okay? So that's one. So that's good. The downside of that, though, is that when you start going down that route, you become fully parametric, right? It's, in other words, it's not this moment-based thing where you can, you know, fix things up anymore. You're really just kind of fully assuming this and going with the structure that you chose. Okay. The other nice thing about the random effects paradigm is sometimes that is actually your scientific goal, right? So sometimes your goal is truly to say, I want to know if people have different slopes and who stands out most from the population. You want to identify those individuals. Again, a marginal model really does not do that to you. You can do it maybe through residual diagnostics or something like that, but it's really an ad hoc way to do it. Whereas if you do the random effect approach, you can actually look at the empirical distribution of these random effects, plot them down with the empirical Bayes estimates, get estimates on them, borrowing off the strength of the population, you can identify these individuals with pigments. Okay, so that's a goal that people often have. So all of that carried through in the continuous data case. Now, if you think about the big picture of things, we're going to do exactly what we did before. Now we're going to go to non-continuous data, so discrete data. Okay? So that's the goal. And we're going to play the same game. I'm going to start off with marginal models first, and then I'm going to go to conditional models, in other words, random effects models. Okay? So there's constantly this kind of duality between these things. So one other thing I will mention actually before I start this lecture is that I also showed the Bayes estimation version, right, of the random effect model. That's what you guys are working on right now at homework. There are a couple of benefits there as well. What are some of the benefits from the Bayes implementation? Yeah, so you can use prior information, right? That's what I think what Arsenio is saying. So the Bayes perspective allows you to incorporate prior information if you have it. That's great. That's one thing. I will speak frankly with you guys. Most of the work that I work on, people over-exaggerate the amount of prior information they actually have on parameters. They don't have that much. And to be honest, that shouldn't come as a surprise because most of the time you wouldn't be doing a study if you had that much prior information. Okay. So it is a nice thing when you've got it, and certainly if you can rule out things that are, like Francis was saying, you know, he's saying, well, some of these values might be impossible, right, in certain situations. So that's kind of nice, you can restrict the parameter space to some degree. Okay. But don't be fooled too much into thinking about how much prior information you might have in a lot of situations. I'm just telling you from my own personal experience. Always question prior information. But again, if your goal is to replicate what you, science is adversarial, right? So if I put a strong prior on what I've known from before, and I say my goal is to replicate, what am I doing? I'm assuming my conclusion, right? So I mean, again, you just gotta be careful about how much weight you're putting on these things and what relative to what your goal is, right? I mean, part of the goal would say, well, if my goal is really replication here, I don't really wanna put too precise of a prior on censoring on the past because that's what I'm trying to do. There's interpretation, right? You guys find the Bayes interpretation easy? Certainly, right? I mean, I think it's the natural thing oftentimes, right? Is, again, when you think about trying to explain what a confidence interval is to somebody, most people will take a confidence interval and they will instantly say the probability that my parameter, and I won't say parameter, but my mean is in this interval is 95%. That is not the interpretation of a confidence interval. The thing that is not random from a frequentist perspective is not the parameter. Endpoints of that confidence interval. And so you're making a probability statement in the frequentist perspective about the sample space, not the parameter space. But the Bayes perspective is actually talking about probability on data given y given data, right? And so that becomes a very natural thing that we can talk about and think about. And so I definitely agree with that. It comes at the cost of the prior specification, which sometimes you can be fairly vague about these things, and so that's good. But also, is there a robust variance estimator from the Bayes perspective? There have been proposals of some coming from, you know, some folks here actually in econ, like Del Poirier's done some work on robust variance estimator versions in the Bayes model, the Bayes linear model. But they're not quite as non-parametric as what you guys have been dealing with in the robust variance estimator that I've been talking about, where you can basically get away with pretty much any assumption other than the first two. They still require a lot of assumptions on the distribution. Okay. So that's one thing. So there's a little bit of a cost there. I would argue the third cost, or the third, I would say, proto, the Bayes perspective from a frequentist, or from a mixed effects model standpoint, is when we did frequentist inference, did you guys actually get any kind of precision interval on the random effect for an individual? I didn't give you one because I don't have one, right? Because what did we model in the frequentist perspective? We just said little b follows some normal, zero, say, tau squared, if I'm not random intercept model, right? And there's no way for me to come back and say, and what is the uncertainty for that individual? I've only got one of that individual on their little b. We were talking about uncertainty relative to the marginal population, but not on the individual. But did you have any kind of concept of uncertainty quantification for little b in the Bayes perspective? Absolutely right. I mean, that last plot that I showed you guys. In lecture 11. Allowed me to do that, right? And those were posterior draws on the individual level estimates that we had. These are marginalizing over uncertainty both in the population level as well as the random effect level. Right, because I had full prior specifications on error rating that was sitting there. I showed you guys plots kind of like this in the frequentist perspective, but what was I doing there? I was just taking individual level data and putting OLS models, right, and showing uncertainty in those things. But that was not incorporating uncertainty at the individual level and the marginal level and trying to pull them together.
These intervals, they're just like sampling based, right?
Exactly. They're all sampling based off the posterior, but because I parameterized everything all the way through on the random effect and the marginal model, I can do that. It's automatic in the posterior draws. So that's kind of a nice aspect of this. I can sit here and I can say, oh, look, if I think about the random slope for a subject 100185, this is my best estimate of what their slope is. Oh, and this is my uncertainty in what that estimate is for that individual. Now, I can give you an uncertainty interval for the empirical, the frequentist version of this estimate, which will be very close to this. You guys are going to see on the one, as long as you're giving big priors. But when I do this uncertainty interval, the only uncertainty I'm capturing is in the population, not at the individual. So Justin, the Bates, not the Louise. So that's a big difference there.
What's your name in the Freedom Perspective?
In the Freedom Perspective, yeah, sorry, if I said. So that's another pro there. So, I mean, again, and when I think about statistics and I think about methodology, I realize that there are lots of ways to attack a problem. And so you got to just consider all the pros and cons about those ways of attacking a particular problem. And so that's what I'm kind of running through you right now. These are all pros and cons. And so that's why when someone says to me, oh, are you a frequentist or a Bayesian? I say, it depends on what I'm trying to do. Right? If someone says to me, do you use marginal models or conditional models? I say, oh, well, it depends on what I'm trying to do. Right? It depends upon what you're doing, because the pros can outweigh the cons in certain situations, regardless of which method you're talking about. So you want to think, well, I want to think about it from that perspective, so I'd encourage you guys to as well. Okay. Good. So now, we're going to step back, we're going to put frequentist hats on for a second again. And we're going to go to the marginal model setting. And so let's get a little bit of motivation here. And, oh, you guys know this. This is your last homework or your last problem on your midterm, right? So this is the Progervide trial. I introduced this in lecture one of this class as well, just as a little bit of motivation for us. Again, 59 independent clusters here, right? So these are patients with epilepsy. The idea of this was a randomized study, so that's nice. You don't have to worry about confounding. Patients got randomized either for Progovide, which was the experimental drug, or placebo. The response was a count response, right? So discrete data, number of seizures recorded in four consecutive two-week intervals, and remember there was a four-week kind of run-in period as well, or an eight-week run-in period. So the question really comes down to saying, look, does Progovide actually reduce the rate of seizures among patients? These were the data. Remember, this looks like an anomaly here, but this is over a longer period. It's like a baseline run-in period that people got randomized, and this is every 2 weeks, the count of seizures, control versus placebo. Okay? So if we wanted to analyze such data, the methods that we have been doing are unlikely to work, and that the reason why is because we have been assuming this constant variance, if you will, coming down the diagonal, but now I'm dealing with count data, I should be having some sort of mean variance relationship, most likely arising in my data, right? If you think Poisson-like process, right, the variance is likely to be rising with my mean. Okay? So I would like to account for that in this, if you will, weighted least squares methodology that we've been doing. The other thing that I would like to account for is realizing if I were to fit a linear model with these data, what's the support of my response? This goes right back to your GL index. It counts. It's positive, right, Hina? So I don't really want to put some sort of unrestricted model on those counts. In other words, fit something that's just linear that would allow me to be estimating negative numbers of seizures, for example. So, how do we deal with that in GLM? By invoking a link function, right? So that's exactly the idea here. So it's the two things that we did in a GLM context. We want to bring in a link function to deal with the support of the response, and we want to bring in some information on the likely mean variance relationship between the response, or with respect to the response, okay? All right, so again, we've seen weighted least squares, LMEs, we've seen the LMEs both from a Bayes and a frequentist perspectives. How can we deal with data for their, say, discrete in nature, either binary or count? The analogs are, to what we have seen, what I'm going to talk about today, which is, again, a semi-parametric approach, we would call it. So generalized estimating equation, which is just going to be specifying an estimating equation coming out, right, which is only going to depend upon how many moments likely, what you guess. Two, right? The mean, definitely, because that's going to answer the scientific question. And then the variance. We've got to deal with the variance as well. Okay? So that's the semi-parametric nature here. So there's nothing else that's going to come into that estimating equation other than the first 2 moments. And then after we get through GEEs, I'm going to show you the analogy to the linear, oops, the analogy to the linear mixed effects model. Sorry about that. Really? the analogy to the linear mixed effects model, which is going to be like the gate-based method. So GLMMs, generalized linear mixed models, and a hierarchical-based version of that, just like we did in the continuous data set. What's going on? So again, just like in the continuous data setting, what we're going to do in the GE framework is we're going to think about the generalized linear model structure. So we'll bring in a link. That's going to characterize the systematic variation right across the covariate levels. But then what I'm going to do with the variance-covariance function is really be treating it as a nuisance. And that's what we were doing before. I was using that thing to gain efficiency in the fact that I had to do inference at the end of the day. It wasn't my primary target of interest. Okay, so it's what we consider a nuisance parameter in the model. Okay. So, what we're going to do is we're going to start off with something that says, okay, if I've got the ith sampling cluster now, and then the jth measurement on the ith sampling cluster, and then covariates that are associated with that jth measurement, we're going to specify that, say, the mean of that guy is going to be mu ij. We're going to invoke a link function, and then have our mean transformed this looks very, very familiar to us. Again, beta is what I'm going to refer to, and this mean that's sitting here, I'm going to consistently now refer to this as the marginal mean. And what I mean by that, what we mean in statistics when we say a marginal mean model means that it is not conditional upon any random effects. When you hear that, there are a lot of terms in statistics that are confusing, but when we say that, that's what it implies, right? And people use double intended, but when somebody says, I've got a marginal model, that means they've marginalized over any random effects inside of that model. Okay. That's what I'm talking about here. No random effects going on. Okay. Total population based. So now, again, the difference between what we had in 2.11 and what we have now, though, is I've got a vector of responses here. And so we're going to assume a couple of things as I've done in the past, right? I'm going to assume that measurements are independent across clusters. Why is it important for me to make that assumption? Again, it's a classic trick in statistics. If you've got independence, then you think about building a model that shares information across those clusters. The most common way to build a model that shares information, assume that you've got a common structure across clusters, right? A common covariance matrix, for example, across the clusters. And so I'll estimate the covariance on each cluster, and then I'll average over each one of them. You've done that all along. And then measurements, though, of course, within a cluster are going to be correlated. We expect that oftentimes by design. For example, if I is an individual, and I'm taking repeated measures on that individual, those measurements are going to be more like themselves than across individual clusters. Okay. Good. So this is pretty easy. What we're going to think about in terms of the mean model and the link function, well, we've already done that. So we're going to take exactly the setting that we had before. So for example, if I've got binary data, I might be thinking about the probability of a success conditional upon covariates. Then I might think about the logit link function now for the jth measurement, I should say, on the ith cluster, and then relating that to the linear predictor. So that's pretty easy for us. We're kind of pros at that little path. Okay. And again, always here I'm talking about marginal mean models. In a little while, we're going to talk about conditional models where we condition upon a random effect, but that's not what I'm doing at this moment. All right, so how do we build in then a variance function on top of the correlation function, right? So that's what we need to do now. That's the big difference between what we had done before beyond the link function, between what we did before for weighted least squares and what we're going to do now. The nice thing that we can do is we're going to kind of separate them. Okay. We're going to think about, I want to talk about the variance for yi conditional upon, say, covariates. then I can decompose that thing in terms of, oh, well, right here, I've got the correlation structure that I'm going to assume. That's what we've been doing all along. We'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But then on the flip side of this, I've got this skirt of a diagonal matrix. And the skirt of that diagonal matrix is what's going to be the diagonal down that variance covariance matrix. And so that's going to identify for me what the mean variance relationship is, right? So we're going to specify separately now an SI that's going to be diagonal of the variance of each individual observation, which is likely to depend upon the mean, as we've seen in the Germeisinger model case. And then we're going to specify the correlation matrix. We've become pretty good at this, right? This is what we've been dealing with, is trying to do EDA for this and then specify it in some reasonable fashion. Last quarter, we became pretty good at this, thinking about what the mean variance relationship was. Now we're just going to pull them together. You guys with me? Natural progression here. But if you remember last quarter, I said, well, you know, the reason why my philosophy oftentimes is just to assume that I'm wrong is because even in the linear model case, or in the independent data case, I should say, we had a hard time sometimes doing this, right? I mean, if I gave you guys count data, like the Progovi data, you didn't know it was Poisson. You didn't know that this thing, if it was Poisson, what would this diagonal be? What would be the diagonal answer? It would just be mu I, right? And so, but you don't know that, right? It could have been negative binomial, it could have been some other mean variance relationship that we had to do diagnostics on. And like I said, the problem really becomes on steroids now, because now we're making an assumption about this, and we're making an assumption about this in order to get the full covariance structure. Correct. And so this is why I'm so skeptical of the fully parameterized models. Okay. So, the correlation structures that we might entertain, oh, they're your classic ones, right? One says, I'll just ignore the fact that I have repeated measures on clusters, and I will use an independence model. Well, guess what? If you use an independence model, and you break it down into this way, what type of model will you be fitting at the end of the day? A GLM, actually. Right? A GLM, right? That's, we're right back into the good old GLM family, right? Just assuming independence across everything.
Is this alpha, it's like, because we have Huysmans parameters?
Exactly. And they're going to come up in just a minute. They don't come up. This is an uninteresting alpha. There's no alpha floating around right now, because I'm just going to assume that it's just diagonal ones. Okay. But my alpha now, for example, a compound symmetric, would just simply say, oh, I've got this common covariance now across all observations within a cluster. Doesn't matter how far apart I measured them, either in time or distance. It's just this common alpha. Good. So we've seen that guy, exchangeable, or sometimes we will refer to it as compound symmetric. We can also think about unstructured, right? Just like we had done before. Unstructured would simply say, look, for every off-diagonal element that I have here, I'm going to allow for a different parameter to vary. Now again, where are we borrowing information? Because we have to be borrowing some information. These things do not depend upon I, right? I'm assuming they need to be constant across independent clusters. But it's still a lot of parameters to be estimating if little n is large. Okay? So in other words, you have lots of repeated measures on the same cluster. So same principle holds, by the way, now that we're talking about non-continuous data. And that is, if you're going to entertain an unstructured covariance matrix, balanced and complete, lots of independent clusters, few measurements on each cluster. Because you're going to have to be borrowing a lot of information to be able to estimate these guys. Good. We might think about an AR process, right? This is one of our friends from before. So I have this common alpha now, and I'm just raising that alpha up to a power. So that's AR1. We might think about a continuous. Oops, do I have it here? I don't have it here. Sorry. You might also then, this would assume equal unit spacing, right, in every one of my measurements. So like the time distance, for example, and measurements on the same subject is always the same. If that was not the case, then what you'd want to do is take this alpha and raise it to what?
Time difference.
Time difference, right, usually. Or if you're talking spatial, then you'd want to take it to be the difference in the space, however you're measuring distance there, okay? All right, and that would be the continuous AR process, okay? And then finally, we might think about something like stationary independence. Again, I called this banded before. That's another popular name for it. The borrowing of information is, it says, each time I go out one step on a measurement, I've got a common alpha 1 that's sitting here. Sorry, I lost it over here. And then maybe as I come out two steps on my measurements, I have a common alpha 2. And in this case, we're calling it independent because now I'm assuming that after I get out past two steps, things start looking independent. Right? So I'll assume that there's no correlation there. Good. All right. A non-stationary independent process would say, oh, first to the second measurement, I get an alpha 1, 2. Second to the third measurement, I get an alpha 2, 3. So that's what we refer to as a non-stationary. And then the independence here with m equals to 2 still says that everything drops off to 0 after I get out past two measurements. Okay? So, again, these things are similar to what we had before. Do we know for a fact that our data is going to follow the structure? No. We're going to do EDA on it to see if it seems reasonable, and then we're going to assume something that's basically a simplification of, most likely a simplification of the list. Good. So now, though, once we have that, if I were to think about that variance-covariance and specify it in this way, and again, this is a really nice way to decompose it. I can think about the correlation matrix, and I can think about the mean variance relationship separately. Then we're right back to where we were before. I'm going to define here capital DI. That's just going to be the derivative of the mean with respect to the parameters, theta. Those, again, fixed effects parameters or marginal parameters. And so if you think about each element of that guy, it's going to be the derivative of the mean for the I cluster at the J measurement with respect to the K parameter inside of the model. Okay. All right. But from that, where are we going back to for our estimating function? Does this look familiar to you guys?
Sure. D mu d beta, V inverse, Y minus V. It's like you say it in your sleep now, right? That's back from 211. Where does this give rise from? Or where does it arise from?
Score
for exponential families, right? Just walking back to exponential families and saying, if I started with an exponential family, I would have something that looks like d mu d beta, V inverse, Y minus V. And that would be my score function.
Seriously? The fun is going to end so soon. We're going to talk about regions. Okay. So, again, we call this a semi-parametric model, and it's called generalized estimating equations because what we're going to do is we're simply going to say, look, I'm going to take my beta and I'm going to estimate it off of this guy. Do I necessarily believe that I fully specified this correctly? No, not necessarily. Okay? But we're going to treat this as an estimator and we're going to go to town on it and we're going to define our beta hats from that by solving that equation. And guess what? We're going to get back to some nice things. Beta hat is going to be a consistent estimator even if the dependence model is misspecified. That's because what type of estimating equation is it?
Unbiased.
Right? You were right. Telling us that. It's going to go off to the thing that makes this expectation go to zero. Well, the expectation of this whole thing is going to look like E of Y minus V. Okay? Great. We'll have correct variances if we've specified the inverse correctly. Those will be model-based. But if we don't specify this V correctly, we're going to have incorrect model-based variances, but what are we going to appeal to? Something like a robust or plug-in variance estimator. And the same principle is going to hold before. You guys are going to look at this on your, while you're doing your final homework for step 212. You'll look and you'll see that as you get closer and closer to the true variance-covariance matrix, in other words, the true dependent structure, you're going to increase efficiency, just like we had seen before. It as a nuisance parameter, but we gain off efficiency. Comes back to good old weighted least squares. And so next time we'll talk about a little bit more of the theory, but this should look a little familiar to you guys. That beta hat is going to solve, is going to converge off to a normal, or we're going to have something that looks like, Fisher information inverse, true variance of the score, or the estimating function, I should say, in the middle, and then Fisher information inverse is if we had specified everything. Same human white result that we've had before, but now in a multivariate case. Okay, so we will do that tomorrow. We'll finish that off and I'll show you guys some examples of fitting. But truly, we have done, and you guys have seen all of the theory here, it's just taking the univariate case to the multivariate case. And so it's all the same principles are applying.
So this model is similar.
So the link, though, isn't really, the link is not an assumption, I will argue. The link defines what?
The model.
Defines the systematic component of the model, how you're going to answer your scientific question, right? I mean, so you condition upon the link, and that's what you're going to do.
Yes, but we still have to see that this comes from the exponential line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, the estimating equation comes from the exponential family. But what makes it semi-parametric is the same principle that we had. It's like we arrived at this estimating equation, and now we're just going to use it to obtain beta hat. We're not necessarily going to believe that it's the true score, mm-hmm. right? Because if we were wrong in the variance-covariance relationship, it wouldn't be the true score, right? So the term semi-parametric really comes from the fact that the estimating equation only depends upon us specifying two moments there. There's no third moment involved, no fourth moment, no full distribution. It could be infinitely dimensional, right, in terms of the other parameters to make it the model.
In general, do we assume that, so if we did say that we still assume exponential family distributions?
No, you don't even assume that, right? That, the exponential family gave rise to that form, right? And there was a nice result, actually, that came out that said that's a reasonable form to consider. What was that result?
Yeah, like it's sufficient, right? It's
sufficient for it as a small variance. Yeah. That was attributable to some chap named Godom, right? Godom said if you give me any unbiased estimating equation, in other words, you put an A in front of Y minus mu, what's the optimal A to choose? The exponential family. So it has, there is theoretical foundation for it, Arseny, but it doesn't necessarily mean that we're stuck inside. And he was going outside of the exponential family model. He was just saying, any Y, just give me an unbiased estimating equation, what's the best weight I can choose? So it's really the nonlinear analog to Gauss-Markov. Because what's coming in A? The inverse, right? Just like Gauss-Markov. And the D mu beta is just coming from the fact that you've got a weak function. Good. All right, so...